One, two, three.
Hello, welcome to Rock the Cash Bar. I'm Ben Mowbray.
And I'm Dianne Gallagher.
Every week we pick one song and do a deep dive into the lyrics and explain the different ways they've been interpreted.
We will also discuss how the song connected to us on a personal level, focusing on all the embarrassing details.
Glad to have you here. Enjoy the show. Happy New Year!
Happy New Year!
Almost. What day is it? December 19th today?
December 19th.
December 19th. I don't even know what day it is. I'm like a relief pitcher in the middle of baseball season. It doesn't matter. Is it Tuesday? It must be an off day.
I feel completely off because we leave for Ireland on Friday, the 23rd. So Santa came to our house early. And so Christmas was yesterday for us.
How was that?
Great. Charlie came downstairs, opened his gifts. We had a great day. I had a really good idea. You know those gingerbread houses everyone builds? I still have a massive bucket of candy from Halloween that I've just stored up and far away and out of sight, out of mind. But when Charlie every now and then is like, I want dessert, I'll just give him a piece of candy. I was like, I'm going to take all that candy out. I'm going to sort it, unwrap everything, and we're going to make the most badass gingerbread house village. And so we've been working on that for 2 days.
Yes.
Like we had an Oreo cookie train and we took all the Kit Kats and laid them out as tracks. I mean, we're going nuts.
It's very like Nightmare Before Christmassy. Right? It was like a full-on like Halloween gingerbread house. I love it. Yeah. Spiders crawling on the gingerbread. How festive.
I know some of the Reese's pieces Reese's were pumpkins, but they were all smushed and you can't tell. They just look like little chocolate blobs. Cause I was like, what am I gonna do with all these little pumpkins? But you can't even tell.
How long are you going to be in Ireland?
10 days. Yeah. So yeah, next week, then on Christmas, what's going to drop is, you guys have already heard it. You're going to hear Fairy Tale of New York, the most Irish Christmas song, while I'm in Ireland actually living it.
It's New Year's Day.
Happy New Year. New Year's
Day is typically the most sober day of my life.
And painful, usually, because you're okay. Sober, yeah, right?
I'm usually. Yeah, see, that's a lot of water. That's a 2 blue Gatorade day. My voice is shut. I was at a Christmas party last night yelling at people, so nice. I apologize. Yeah.
Were you working it or were you enjoying it?
I was enjoying it.
Okay.
I got off of work and then I went to a Christmas party and I was greatly enjoying it, yes.
Nice. Did you go to one of those fun festive Christmas bars in Houston that's all decorated?
This one was decorated, but not all the way up. There's a thing, it's called Miracle, and it's a group that Beach Bum Berry puts together, and it's insane. Like you have to dress your bar up like nuclear Christmas. Like it's no fair just to dress it up as Christmas. It has to be all the way winter wonderland. And then they bring you all these different like festive syrups, and you have to make their cocktails exactly the way that they want it made, and in the Santa mugs and glasses. It's really, really a lot of fun. If you're going to the bar,
right?
If you're working that bar, it's an unbelievable pain in the ass.
I bet.
I always tell people, it's like, how much fun did you have at your office Christmas party? Like, oh, not much. Like, well, really? I've been to 18 office Christmas parties. This is not fun. That's why I'm in a bad mood every Christmas.
Nice. But you had fun last night.
I did have fun last night because I didn't have to work the Christmas party. I was not in costume. I was just enjoying myself.
Good for you.
So happy New Year, everybody. Welcome to the New Year's episode of Rock the Cash Bar. We're going to do New Year's Day by my favorite band, U2.
Yes.
I've always loved this song. It was U2's like breakout hit. It came out in 1983 and it was
I didn't realize that.
Yep. This one was like their announcement to the world, like here we've arrived.
Yeah.
And it's kind of interesting when you look back on it now. Like, I don't know if this is the way it felt at the time because I was only 3. But when I listen to New Year's Day, it's when I can most realize that Bono and the boys really did want to be the Clash. Like there really was that moment in their life where they were absolutely trying for the Clash's mantle. And in contemporary times, like the Clash was still a very, very big band in 1983. So it wasn't like they were chasing history or anything like that. They were literally like chomping at the heels of the biggest band in the world. Like they were deliberately aping and trying to take down the biggest band in the world, and you can hear it.
You are so correct. This whole album is political, and this is on war, right? Is that the name of the album? You're absolutely right. I would have never put that together.
You're absolutely doing it. So New Year's Day was originally, it's obviously, we'll go through the lyrics, but it's a love song. It sounds like a love song. Yes. You don't know what it's about, but it's explicitly, like, within the text, it's not just a love song. Like, when you read the quote, let's just go into the lyrics. Here we go. So this is New Year's Day by YouTube. So it opens with the big Bono caterwaul. Yeah.
My favorite. All is quiet on New Year's Day. The world is wild. It's on the way. I want to be with you night and day. Nothing changes on New Year's Day.
All is quiet on New Year's Day. A world in white gets underway. All right, we're setting the scene. Mm-hmm. I want to be with you night and day. Nothing changes on New Year's Day. So it's a love song, and it's a pretty rote love song. I mean, he's got some imagery and everything like that in there, but I mean, it's really just these two lovers are being kept apart. And then the chorus is the promise. I will be with you again. I will be with you again. Love song, just an old-fashioned love song.
Love song, and you know, and we haven't told the listener yet that to me this song has a duality. He initially started writing it for his wife, but then also we're gonna get into the solidarity movement. I like listening to the song knowing that he's trying to skirt the line of both. He wants it to be a love song, but you can also understand in the next verse what's going on in Poland.
Yeah, it's a love song about an actual character. So the next verse is
under a blood red sky. A crowd is gathered, black and white. Arms entwined with chosen few. The newspaper says,
under a blood red sky, a crowd has gathered in black and white. So he's having some fun with the imagery. There's a blood red sky, but the crowd is in black and white. Like, it's newspaper print, isn't it? Like,
he's
saying, like, the world is big and violent and colorful, and we can't control it in any way, but we learn about it through black and white. We learn about it through those photos. We learn about it through the newsprint. Arms entwined, the chosen few, the newspaper says it's true. So it's no longer just a love song. Like, it's clear there's some kind of movement going on here. Like, it's obviously political. There's a whole crowd with their arms entwined. They're the chosen few, and the newspaper's talking about it. It's not just a love song anymore.
Right, right. We can break through the time and two. We can be
one. I will begin again. Though we're, okay, say it's true, and we can break through, though torn in two, we can be one. I will begin again, I will begin again. It's not I will be with you again, it's I will begin again in this one. And then there's, like you're talking, this is the duality you're talking about, though torn in two, we can be one. Like, obviously that's a love song thing, but it's obviously about whatever social fabric is being rendered, you know, here, whatever violence, whatever tumult you're going through. He's talking about these groups of people getting back together again.
Right.
He's doing it both ways.
I love a song that does this. I love a song that can have two completely different messages at once, whichever one you want to pay more attention to, whatever time you're going through in your life. it's almost kind of pussy-like too, where he's like, I want to do a political activist song, but not just fully, because I can't fully just be the dead Kennedys right now. So I'm also gonna also make it a love song. You can take it however you want it.
He was connecting with it in both ways. Like, this was originally a song that he was writing for his wife, Ali. And you can clearly see that in the first verse. But I think as he started to read more about what was going on, specifically in Poland, and this character of well, I call him a character, but he's obviously an actual man, Lech Walesa was a electrician in a shipyard in Gdansk, which was then the Lenin shipyard. It was, Poland was under Soviet control at the time. And Lech Walesa was the founder of the Polish Solidarity Movement, which I don't know a whole lot about. I've read a little bit about it, but it's basically a labor union. And it was the first labor union that was given any power, any negotiating power in the entire Soviet Union, like in the entire Soviet bloc, which is mind-blowing to me. You consider like the Soviet is supposedly the workers' revolution, and there's no trade unions. Like it's difficult to wrap your head around the scale of the corruption and the scale of the fascism, really. You know, like right. it's a totalitarian government that ostensibly in the voice of the workers is nonetheless stepping on the throats of the workers. Like it's just an absolute mind fuck. It's impossible. There's volumes written about this era in Soviet history. I'll never understand it, how it came to be.
No, me either. It's one of those things, like there's some parts of history that I find really interesting and I can really dig into and learn everything. And then there's this stuff that I'm like, I can't even begin. It's so deep.
Yeah, other parts that are just straight up baffling, like the Bolshevik Revolution overthrows the Romanovs, which were by far the most brutal royal family in Europe at the time. So here they are, like they're literally, you know, the Onion makes the joke that they're goateed coffee house types seizing power in Moscow. But as soon as they do, like it's no longer, there's no idealism anymore. There's no, like, it's just straight up, here comes the brutality.
Right.
It's like, in order to hold on, in order to hold that many millions of people over that many millions of square miles, like you're going to need the tanks. That's just all there is to it.
Which is, can you imagine living in that world?
No, I don't want to imagine living in that world. And it's scary to think how close we are to living in that world. Like, part of why this song is still relevant today is because the world is going to turn on a knife's edge, on a real macro level. As the pendulum switches, like all through the 20th century, the pendulum was swinging towards liberal democracy. And I don't mean liberal in the American sense, like in the Western democratic sense.
Right.
Now that pendulum is coming back and it's swinging over
it
to the
right.
It
wants to. I think it's going to meet resistance, though. It feels like it wants to, but we're like, ah, no. We're not going to let it happen.
But that's the scary thing, is that like we're literally... We're literally making a break from those who died. Like it's difficult for me to talk about because it's just so shocking to see. I never would have thought it after all the history that I've read of World War II and World War I and growing up in the 20th century, to see all of the fighting and all of the struggles of the 20th century just being just laughed off as if they're nothing. You know, I was in a bar after the 2016 election and somebody was talking about, well, what's going to happen in Europe? You know, what's going to happen in Poland? What's going to happen in Ukraine? And there was a Trumper in the bar, just goes, oh, fuck Poland. You're like, fuck Poland? Like, isn't that what you're, that's what all of our granddaddies went over there and died for.
Yeah.
Literally the struggle that we're standing on top of. Like, this is literally the victory of Western democracy. And you're just like, oh, fuck it. Like, I couldn't, and obviously that's just one drunk in a bar.
Right. But they don't represent everybody. You always have to keep that in mind. They really represent a minority. They really do.
But God, it's easy to forget that. It's easy to forget that they're not a minority, or that they are a minority.
Yeah.
Anyway, back to this very cheerful New Year's Day song. Oh, maybe the time is right. Maybe tonight I will be with you again. I'll be with you again. And then the coda to the song, and obviously the theme. And so we're told this is the golden age, and gold is the reason for the wars we wage. Though I want to be with you night and day. Nothing changes on New Year's Day.
Mm-hmm.
Always. There's a weird sort of positive and negative to that.
Yes. It starts off like, to me, it was like the newspapers say it's true. We're going to break through. We're going to, and then it's back to nothing changes. Am I reading that right?
I think you can read it both ways. Like, I think it's absolutely, though I want to be with you night and day, nothing changes on New Year's Day. Like, the struggle is going to go on because the struggle is eternal. I think you can see it that way. But you could also see it in terms of the love song, where it's just like, I want to be with you I want to be with you night and day. And that's never going to change either. You know, yeah. Like the struggle is always going to be there, but the love is also always going to be there.
Yeah.
And I think that's Bono's full circle opinion of himself and his religion,
right. Yeah.
His ego and his power is just like, I will be, you know, he's like Bill Clinton. I'll be with you until the last dog dies. It's onward, Christian soldiers, forever.
I love Bono gets me. I mean, he, when it comes to like getting in my heartstrings, we've talked about him so much, especially in our sad songs episode. It's the wailing. Everybody knows Dianne loves some like heartfelt pain wailing. Even the first line out of this song is just him screaming in pain. And I'm like, I'm in. Whatever you're going to tell me, I'm in. Like, I love you. And then the repetition of I will be with you again. I will be with you again. It's back to like, what's the other song I like of his that was on the soundtrack with Winona Ryder and Ethan Hawke?
All I Want Is You.
All I Want Is You. The way he repeats these things, it's the repetition of just like, I will be with you again. I will be with you again. I will be with you again. Or, you know, he's so dramatic and so sad. And he's like, he's just throwing his heart out and I fall for it.
And looking back on it now, like you buy it from him. Like I could imagine like in 1983, Bono is 23. And they're just this weird band that, I mean, it's a hot bass riff that New Year's Day, you know,
it's
comes
great.
In. Like part of that is just that fantastic intro, then the piano, then the guitars, the great big yeah. Like it's they're inviting you into this tableau, but they're 23-year-old dudes.
Yeah.
And they're singing about a land that they don't live in and a struggle that they're probably too young to really understand. Like I can definitely see rock critics or 43-year-old dudes like me in 1983 really sniffing at U2 and just going, oh, fuck you.
You know.
But when you look back at it over the course of time, like here's a guy who's writing a love song to his wife and then also tying it in to the Cold War, which is a pretty ambitious thing for a 23-year-old to do.
Yeah.
To know that he's still married to the same woman and has four children 40 years later is right. Pretty impressive. Like it's impressive to go like, okay, this guy kept his promises, you know, yeah. To say that I will be with you again. I will be, you listen to it now. And you're just like, he wasn't lying. Like,
yeah. He wasn't a dumb kid talking out of his ass. Yeah.
Was a dude taking himself seriously in the world.
I do want to point out, and not enough, I'm just, this is a quick aside. The show on Apple TV called Bad Sisters. It's got like my favorite Irish actress. It's got these four girls. It's a great show. And the youngest girl is Bono's daughter. And she's great. She's really yeah. good in it. And I would have never known she was Bono's daughter. She kind of has an Emily Blunt look to her. But as soon as I realize she's Bono's daughter, that's all I can see. She looks just like him, but in real pretty. And real pretty.
A real pretty version of Bono.
It is. She's got real pretty eyes, but you can see it in the jaw. And you're like, oh, yep, that's Bono's daughter.
It's so weird because Bono always looks like such a, like he's just like such a runty, like dock worker looking guy to me. If you take away like the rock star hair dye and shades right. and everything like that, like he's just got a metal lunchbox and he's on his way down to the shipyards, you know.
You would think like him and drag would be awful, but then you see his daughter, you're like, oh no, it works. I think she looks enough like her mom too, that's what makes her really pretty.
They did drag in the video for One. He's actually kind of a he's actually kind of a frightening looking woman.
Yeah. A lot of they guys drag are.
Dull the masculinity off of that face.
Yeah.
They just put some lipstick on it.
That's a jawline that needs to be a little bit of work, genetic work to work on a lady. Let's talk about the video, because one thing that I found really funny is in the beginning scene where it has them, you're supposed to think it's the band riding on horses. They couldn't make it to do it, so it's four teenage girls.
four teenage girls from Sweden riding horses through the snow.
It's not them.
Video to watch. It's 1983, so it's the early days of MTV, the early days of music videos. So you have to forgive it, but it is just such a, it's the most U2 thing that you could imagine, because it's all stark. It's all black and white. Like they literally went to the coldest part of Sweden they could find because they wanted it to be.
Yeah. You know what's funny is The Cure did that with Pictures of You. Their video is them in just stark white snow. But YouTube is a little more dramatic.
Like obviously it's just like, oh, I'm out here in the cold loneliness of my missing you.
Yeah.
YouTube's using the snow to say, we're going to fight in the wintertime too. And the video's got like, it's interspersed with shots of the actual Russian army in World War II, you know, like the tanks advancing. You know, it's just, it's absolute madness to say, like, well, just the idea that a rock band at 23 years old, like right out of the get-go, is going to involve themselves so completely in international struggle is just such a, it's such an arrogant swing of the bat.
You know what, Ben, I gotta say, I remember being 20 and I remember in my 20s and being in college and how politically activated everyone was at that age. Just if we had had social media back then, everyone I went to college with would have just been tweeting what the 20-year-olds are tweeting now, just like the railroad strike and this and that. And I'm just like, and when you're 45 and you've seen so many of these things come and go, you're like, are you going to do anything about it? Or are you just going to fucking tweet about it? You know, you're like, you kind of just get like, shut up. You don't know what you're talking about.
It's hard not to get that tired. One of the great Bono quotes is that he says, when you're 16, you think you can take on the world. And sometimes you're right. Like, I think he understands that he and his friends are obviously exceptional. I don't think he understood it when he was 23, but I think at 63, he absolutely does.
Yeah.
You know, I think he looks back on it and realizes that it was a miracle. You know, like he took this great big arrogant swing of the bat and somehow or another it worked out for him. And now he feels obligated to continue.
Right.
You know, he feels like, all right, this gift has been given to me for whatever reason. I got to run with it.
Yeah. I never really think that he's virtue signaling the way people are now. They just want to show that they have empathy for a thing, but they don't want to do anything about it. But like, he uses his fame to do something about it. So it's like, all right, well, good. Prove yourself.
And what can you do? What can I do? You know, like anything that we would do is just going to seem empty and is going to seem like virtue signaling, like donating to a charity and then making sure that everybody knows that
make
you
sure
donated.
Everybody saw that you did it. Yep.
Understand how ugly that looks, but also at the same time, it's like, how else are you going to point people? Like, here's a good charity and here's the PayPal portal.
Here's how you can also do it. And I know that's the overriding point is like, I'm showing you that I did it to try to get you to do it, but it's, there's a duality to it too. It's like, well, look how great I am.
Look at the special me.
Don't look at the other shady shit that I'm doing behind the scenes all the time. Just look at how great I am. Yeah. Yeah.
I'm a soldier in God Bono's army. I was reading about it's going to be my deep cut song, but this song, the bass line, which I have always loved, like I think is absolutely just so stirring. Adam Clayton is the bassist of U2, and he's famously not a very good musician. The famous U2 story is that the founding of the band is Larry Mullen Jr. is the drummer, and he's the youngest in the band. He was 14 at the time. He puts up a flyer on the school bulletin board that just says drummer seeks bandmates. So they assemble in Larry Mullen's kitchen, and you know, Bono says that he can play guitar, but he pretty quickly admits that he doesn't really know how to play guitar. The Edge is there with his brother, and they have built a guitar to get, like, they literally built an electric guitar. They assembled it out of parts that they found around the garage, and they really did know how to play it. And Adam Clayton showed up with his bass guitar, saying that he knew everything about, he was using words like gig and just real musician stuff. He was the coolest guy in the band. But he assured them that he absolutely did know how to play the bass. And then as they cracked it open and started playing songs, it became very clear to everybody that Adam Clayton had no fucking idea.
Balls on this dude, and he's still with them.
So music, Larry Mullen he was playing like in the marching bands and school bands. He was playing drums. So he was the most skilled musician by far. Edge was a self-taught guitar player. Clayton had to go and take lessons. he had to go seek help. So this song came about. There's a song, there's a band called Visage, which I'd never heard of, and a song
I never knew if it was Visage or Visage, but you're right. Yeah, I don't know.
I presume it's Visage. I don't know. Visage? Visage? I don't know how they
We don't know it. Shit.
Their song, Fade to Gray, is what Adam Clayton was trying to learn to play on the bass when he came up with the bass riff for New Year's Day. You can kind of hear it in that song. You can sort of see where it was coming from. But it reminded me of one of my favorite musical memories. A friend of mine is a drummer. She's a very, very good drummer. And I would go over to her house and she would just like, okay, she would give me her bass guitar. She's like, just play the bass. Like, I have no fucking idea how to play the bass. It's like, it doesn't matter. Just pick a song in your head. Okay. Listen to the bass line. All right. Now just try to do a reasonable facsimile of that. I'm like, all right. So I would do it and it would be terrible, but she would listen to a couple of bars and then just immediately start playing along to it. And it was just her practicing the drumming, like figuring out how the rhythm section fits in. It doesn't matter that I'm not playing the right notes. What matters is that the rhythm is there and she was playing off of that.
Interesting. If it someone were to hand me a guitar, a bass, anything, it's like, just play something. I'm like, you might as well hand me a spatula and a whisk and say play. Because I'm like, I don't know which way. Do I hold it this way? What do I do with my hands? I'm just like, I don't know how to play music.
Everything's a musical instrument if you know how to hold it right.
I'm like, you got to show me a chord. You got to show me something. I can go after that. I have rhythm. I can strum, but like just play. I'm like, what? I can't.
Lanton won't. You got to work at it. I'm up to 6 chords now.
Good for you. I need to just do it. I always get so frustrated because I don't have hands. I have paws. My fingers are so short. And it hurts. I don't want to build up the little calluses you're supposed to build up. And I don't want to cut my nails off. And I can't spread my fucking fingers. I can't do it. So I'm just like, forget it.
Do you want to see if we can make a New Year's resolution and see if we can find one day a week to take our lessons together?
I could actually do it with my son at School of Rock. But they teach adults too. It's not just for kids. Mm-hmm. I see adults go in there, so I wouldn't be embarrassed. But yeah, I should just do it.
By the end of next year, we can go to a singer-songwriter open mic and bare our souls with the poets.
Okay. My New Year's resolution is, what'd you say?
Said you look nonplussed and terrified.
Yeah, you're just adding to my resolutions. My New Year's resolution is to actually do the New Year's resolution I set last year and do a live podcast. We almost did it in October. We had like things in place to do it, but then we went to Disney the weekend before, and then I was throwing a Halloween party the next weekend. I just didn't have it in my soul to do it. So this year we're gonna do a live podcast somewhere.
Promised. If you listen to Fade to Gray by Visage, you can sort of hear the bass line in there somewhere. But the greatest thing about that song is the video. You've got to go to YouTube and look at Visage's Fade to Gray, because we should go as like for next Halloween, we need to go as Visage, because it's a male female duo. Nice. And it's the most 80s thing you've ever seen. It's just a whitewash screen. They're in ridiculous costumes. The makeup is preposterously over the top, and they're just doing just like the 80s dramatic poses. Video is very new.
Yes. Damn it. I can't now, because I have so many deep cuts lined up that I want to do. And I know that that's going to be your deep cut. And it makes me want to do a different deep cut that has the exact same video. It's a song called Change Your Mind by Gary Numan. And it's just the most 80s goth numbers, like black and white, stark, like poses. It's almost exactly like what you're explaining. God, shit. Yeah, I know, I'm going to love it.
And it's also fun to think about it just New Year's Day is obviously it's a worldwide anthem. And to think that it came about because some guy who doesn't really know how to play the bass was trying to learn to play this very, very cheesy 80s synth pop, long forgotten song. Like,
I love Fade to Gray. I listen to it. It's in my shuffle. I love that song. Yeah. Yeah.
Fantastic little tune. But it's weird to think that it's a footnote for this song that's in everybody's head and everybody's heart. It's weird to think that that's where these things are born.
That's really fun. I didn't know this, that they said in concert, like The Edge plays the piano part of the song, and he'll do it while his guitar is on him. He'll play the piano and then he gets up and walks to the front and plays guitar, and the audience goes crazy.
Yeah, that was it's the kind of showy thing, because the criticism of The Edge, there's a great documentary called It Might Get Loud. And it came out in like 2008 or something like that. And it's Robert Plant, The Edge, and Jack White. And the sort of the the premise is that these three great guitarists from three different eras using three different techniques are all going to get together in a warehouse and jam and talk about guitars. So they sort of follow him. And there's obviously there's a segment on Jack White and then a segment on U2 and a segment on Robert Plant where they talk about the sources of their inspiration and how they wrote some of their most famous songs and everything like that. The opening scene is Jack White building a guitar himself.
Oh my God.
Just out on his porch in Tennessee, building an electric guitar, like with a Coke bottle and just stringing up wires. It's absolutely amazing.
That's awesome.
But they showed the Edge at Windmill Lane Studios in Dublin, where he basically, you know, sets up, and he's it, like, it's just nothing but technology. It's all phasers. It's all computers. It's all everything. And you know, hundreds of thousands of knobs and little dials and turns. And like, he's just got all the technical stuff. So there's an English comedian that does a joke where he's on stage with an electric guitar and he's just playing some dumb chord and it sounds terrible. And then the big joke is he steps on a pedal and now all of a sudden it sounds exactly like the Edge. And he's just right. Like, you see this dumb, like, yeah, it would be dumb if he was doing it the first way. Of course that would be dumb. But he is using the phaser, which does make it sound good.
Right.
Would be ridiculous if he was just playing a four-string guitar.
You can't like hate on him for that, and then also like so much of modern music uses that voice, what is it called, auto-tune?
Yeah.
Like everybody's favorite band right now is using it just in your face on purpose, and I hate it. I don't appreciate it as a good tool for music. I think it's stupid, and so you can't hate the Edge for doing that and then be okay with these singers using auto-tune.
That was the real criticism of the Edge in the early days of U2, is that he was obviously trying to be like the riff master. Like U2 was very guitar forward, but the guitar riffs were preposterously simple. Like the opening of I Will Follow, their first single from like 1980, is literally just three high notes, three low notes, three high notes, three yeah. low notes. Like, so he was getting a lot of criticism from the music press and from snotty critics that were just like, he doesn't really know how to play that. He's not a real musician. So the Edge went between Boy and October. He took piano lessons and actually learned chord progressions and how to read sheet music and everything like that. So New Year's Day was sort of his coming out party, his way of saying, like, I will play both because I do know how to do it. Thank you very much, NME.
He's also like, give me a minute. I'm young. Let me figure this out and grow.
23 years old. Let me sort this out.
Yeah. And you know what? There's some beauty in simplicity. I'm just going to say, like, a lot of the songs that hit me in my heart from like the 80s, it was the time of the Casio keyboard. I love dun 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 dun. That's a huge song because it's a little catchy piano Casio tune. I love it. I'm sorry.
Bono hates it. Bono is only excited. Like, he's got so many quotes that are just things like, well, I'm really happy about this album because the Edge is just sticking with the guitar. He's not futzing around on the piano on this one.
That's funny.
It's a damn shame because some of U2's like high moments, obviously the New Year's Day piano is incredible. The song October off of October is a fun little piano one. He's got some good piano tunes in there.
Is the piano in Stay? That's like both of them. We love Stay so much.
Yeah, I do love that song. I think there's a piano line in that. I don't know. I'd have to go.
Maybe not.
Also, I don't think that the Edge has appeared in public without a hat on since 1986. I'm really curious. Yeah, I think he's fully and completely bald. I don't think, you know, I think Bono is clearly going plugs and coloring his hair. I think the Edge is when I'm just gonna age gracefully. Thank you very much. I will age gracefully beneath a rotating series of caps.
It would be so funny if it were wrong and his hair is like mine and he doesn't want to take it off and just be like, this is the horrible shit I'm working with and I didn't want to embarrass everybody.
Russian thick tiger's mane.
This is like Fabio coming out and he's like, I just didn't want to be loved for my looks. Don't hate me because I'm beautiful. That would be really funny, but that's not what happens.
Mm-hmm. So Bono wrote this song, like I keep calling Lech Walesa a character, but I really do think that Bono sort of began to see him as a character, because what happened to Lech is he was arrested several times as the leader of this labor movement. He's like literally arrested and thrown into Polish prisons, into Soviet prisons in Poland. So Bono says he was thinking about his wife, obviously, when he started to write this song, but also thinking about the struggles were going on all over the world, and he sort of clung to Lech Walesa, what was happening in Poland, and realized that there must have been a moment when he's in prison where he's doing both things, you know, where he's trying to lead his labor movement, but he's also missing his family and missing his wife, you know, and writing letters from a prison cell, basically saying, I will be with you again.
Oh, I like that.
Yeah. And you can certainly see parallels. Like you could definitely see a world where New Year's Day isn't about Lech Walesa. Maybe it's about Nelson Mandela. You know, you could.
Yes.
He's done it a couple of times. You know, there's not New Year's Day, but Pride in the Name of Love is about Martin Luther King Jr. Mm-hmm. Bono was originally writing that song about Ronald Reagan.
That's right.
He was writing it, and eventually he realized he didn't want to write a song about a guy that he disagreed with. He didn't want to write a takedown. He wanted to write, you know, a song about a real man, as Bono put it. And so he switched to Martin Luther King. I think you definitely see a world where New Year's Day is about any political leader, any political dissident in the early 80s. It just happens to be that Bono settled on Lech Walesa.
Right.
There's another weird coincidence that Bono claims that they named the song New Year's Day, and then quite coincidentally, martial law was lifted in Poland on New Year's Day.
Yes.
That is not true.
No, I was like, really? That's a wild coincidence.
It didn't happen, and I don't know how it got in his head, and I don't know why people don't call him on it, but that's not the case. New Year's Day was recorded on New Year's Day 1983 at Windmill Lane Studios, and that's why it's called New Year's Day.
Got it. That makes more sense. Yeah,
it really does. It's that simple. There you go. That's the story behind the song. What a surprising twist. They recorded it on New Year's Day.
There you go. End of story. Wasn't there something in my notes about wanting to call it Under a Blood Red Sky, or they did on an album later? I know that that line pulled from this song got used a lot later. And I know there's a friend of mine that's in a band called Blood Red Sky. It's a tribute band to U2.
There was a concert film that they recorded at Red Rocks in Colorado called Under a Blood Red Sky. And obviously the Red Rocks Amphitheater is very dramatic, you know, American desert. So it was a great backdrop for them. They recorded that and then released an album called Under a Blood Red Sky after war. And that was sort of like, it was their big announcement. Like war was sort of the breakthrough, like, hey, there's this new, you know, kind of punky political band coming out of war-torn Ireland that's worth a listen to. And then they sort of captured that. And they captured that on Under a Blood Red Sky.
Yes, yes.
And that was like Under a Blood Red Sky is peak, like Bono waving the white flag and bouncing around the stage. And it's got it's where he has the famous intro to Sunday Bloody Sunday, where like,
yes,
there's been a lot of talk about this next song. Maybe too much talk. It's like the founding bombast of Bono and U2, and it's fun to watch if you've taken your Pepto-Bismol.
That's funny.
But you definitely see people watching this being like, how did this guy, what, why?
I know.
Stop it, just take it down a notch.
That's how I feel so often.
Bono,
like, oh, shut up.
No kidding. He's on a book tour. He wrote a book. It's called Surrender, and he takes 40 U2 songs and tells the story of how he wrote it, and through that he tells the story of himself and his family and the band and everything like that. And he's showing some of that Bono humility now, you know, where he's like sort of apologizing for that bombast and understanding. He's got some funny lines about it. He goes, my own father told me that I'm a baritone who thinks he's a tenor. There are things that I didn't realize that are coming out. Like, I haven't read the book yet, but I've watched interviews with him. Bono's father was an opera singer, not a professional opera singer, but he was into the opera. He would sing in church, and he would sing, you know, in amateur operas, and he would sing, you know, just like around the house. But he never pursued a career because he thought it was ridiculous to think that he could make a career as a musician. So Bono was just like, I guess there is some level of patricide to what I'm doing, where like I'm literally trying to succeed where my father was afraid to,
yeah, to fail. Mm-hmm. I wonder how his dad feels about that. Like,
they had a strange
pride, hopefully pride, right?
There's kind of a famous story where the first time his dad saw them play in America, like he'd seen them play in you know, smaller like Irish clubs, but he didn't realize how big that they were truly getting. Until he came to see them play a stadium in Dallas in the mid 80s, somewhere around there. And so the members of U2, they play the show and they do like the full on U2 playing to thousands of people. They get into the dressing room. And then of course, like the manager's like, oh, Bono, your father's here to see us. His dad comes into the dressing room and apparently all his dad says to him is just, you were very professional.
Thanks, Dad. Warmed my heart, felt seen.
No, but there are, like, Bono's written a couple of songs. His mother died famously when he was very, very young, when he was 15, and left him and his brother, his older brother, and his dad sort of alone in the house. And that became like the real emotional marker for him. And apparently it's a thing that a lot of big, like really big musicians have in common. Both John Lennon and Paul McCartney lost their mothers at early ages. So the joke that they make is that, not the joke, but the observation that they make is that you have that great big hole in your soul. You can only fill it by playing to stadiums full of people.
Oh, yeah.
I don't know if that's true, but I mean, it's nice to think about in a romantic sort of way.
Well, if Charlie wants to make it big in music, I'm going to have to off myself, I guess.
That would be very self-sacrificing. You could just leave. You could just go and just never be found.
And then just like peep at his concerts, like, I did this. You're welcome, everybody.
You see that emotional damage there? I did that. Mommy did
it. My gift to the world. I'm actually a
I withheld my love from my son until he learned to play the guitar.
Yes. What a piece of shit.
He ended up writing, Bono's father died, died pretty slowly in the early 2000s. And U2 obviously is constantly on tour. So Bono was doing the sting thing, you know, the private jet, you know, we'd go and like play a show in Spain and then private jet back home and spend the night, you know, bedside at the hospital and then go out the next day. He was really like working some just insane hours, just sitting there. There's famous pictures of Bono just like in full stage gear. But you think, does he just wear that all the time? Like, you think, like, what an asshole. Like, you're sitting at your deathbed and you're still in your rose tinted glasses and your leather jacket. And everything. Like, no, he literally would get off the stage, get on the plane, and come back to dad's bedside. Yeah. And they ended up writing a couple of different songs about it, you know, and a couple of Sometimes You Can't Make It on Your Own is all about his father and his father's passing. You know, and it's just, and it literally has like a line that alludes to him growing up with his dad singing opera. It's just like, you know, hey dad, I gotta let you know, you're the reason why the opera is in me. Like, aww. It's, once you know, you're just like, you listen to that song again, you're just like, hey, I gotta call my dad.
I cannot believe it's kismet how all this is tying into my deep cut. It all relates, and I didn't even mean for it to.
What's your deep cut?
Let's go ahead and go to, are we done? Is there anything else you want to talk about here?
No, we're there. I think we did it.
Okay. Yeah, I let Jeremy off for the rest of the year. I'm not going to make him do U2 again. I keep forgetting this comes out on New Year's Day. Welcome to 2023. Yeah, no Jeremy this week. He is off, but he will be back whenever we come back. Okay, so your deep cut, because I need a place to actually now insert it, is Fade to Gray.
Mm-hmm.
Which is a great song. It's in my, I listen to it. It comes on, I listen to Sirius First Wave in my car, and the song plays on there all the time. I think it's a great song. Mm-hmm. I can't wait to see the video. I'm going to tell people, for those of you who watch on YouTube, every now and then I can't play clips at all. And it all depends. Like, I make the episode, I put it out, or I upload it, and then I find out if there's a copyright infringement. Some will let you play it, but they won't let you make any money off of it. I don't make any money off of it anyway. Some, every now and then I'll put one up and it's like, nope, it's blocked completely. You cannot play this video. And so sometimes I can get away with it if I just play, like, I put up the picture, not the official video, and or mm-hmm. just like, you know, someone's karaoke lines, and I can get away with it that way. But I always try to put the video in. So hopefully I can put the video of Fade to Gray in, because you said it's great. Okay. Okay, my deep cut is from one of my favorite local Texas bands, the Toadies, which we have done a full episode on, but it's a song off their Heretics album, and it's called The Appeal. Mm-hmm. And it's so good. Like, the thing about it, it has a duality, just like what we're talking about here. It sounds like, let's see, what did I write down? It sounds like it's a love song about a strained relationship that is, they're broken up. But, you know, if you hear most songs, you think of it as a love song, like between a man and a woman, and he's appealing this to this person to rebuild their broken relationship, and he's trying to forgive this person, but knowing it's falling on deaf ears and the person's just done. So it just sounds like a breakup that's done, and he's begging them to, like, you know, rebuild their relationship. But the true story is this isn't a song he written for a woman. He wrote it about his father. So, ooh. Apparently the lead singer had, as he became an adult, became estranged from his dad, or they don't see things the same way. And it almost sounds political. Like, he grew up, became a liberal. His dad's a staunch Republican. They fight, they don't talk to each other, but it sounds like he's begging him for a relationship. Like, it doesn't matter how old you are as an adult, you still want to reconnect and have the love of your father. And it's really sad. And he's just telling his dad, I forgive you, but I've made my appeal. I know you're not going to respond, but he's basically saying, like, I've done my work. It's out there. You can have a relationship with me or not.
Oh, that's heartbreaking.
It's heartbreaking when you hear it in that vein. When you just listen to it and it sounds like a breakup song, you're like, eh. But when you hear it and be like, he's making this appeal to his father, it's tears. It's so sad.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So it made me think when you're talking about Bono and his dad, and I was like, you know, I can imagine this song, the guy, you know, his father's now dying and he's still trying to make that appeal to, you know, like,
literally like actively seeking his acceptance. Like, is it okay that I've done this? Like, is it okay that I've, you know, I've blown my life out all over the world?
And
and there's something very Irish to it as well, because he would talk about how, like, on Sundays when Bono would be back in Dublin, he would go and have a, like, that was the tradition, he'd go and have a pint with his dad, you know, every Sunday at the kitchen table. And you could see him like at 25 or 26, you know, like, sitting with his dad, who'd be in his 50s. And it was like this is you know, Joshua Tree era Bono. Like, this is the guy who wrote With or Without You. This is world conquering Bono sitting at the kids' table at his dad's elbow, drinking a Guinness. Hey, Dad, this is what we're planning on doing.
Oh, I love it. Mm-hmm. Another thing that's great about The Appeal is it does the thing that I love so much that U2 does, is it starts slow and he's singing very slow. And at the end, he's wailing. He's screaming these lyrics to his dad. Like, it sounds like he's crying to his dad.
I wish I could tell you
comes back low again and makes his final appeal, and the song ends, and it's just, I'm a ball of tears every time I listen to this song.
Oh, I'm gonna listen to it and cry.
It's very good.
I'm gonna listen to it, cry, and then call my dad and talk about the Edmonton Oilers
and appreciate that you guys are bonded and there's no Well, happy new year, everybody. I have no idea what the next song is that we're doing, unless you have one in the pocket you want to do. I'm just going to go to Ireland, have fun, and come back and be like, all right, let's do 2023 now.
Come back and we'll restart the cash bar. Happy New Year, everyone.
Happy New Year.
And Vogue.
So this is the way that I feel. And I forgive you. I've made my appeal.
1, 2, 3. Rock the Cash Bar is produced by Diane Gallagher, music by Chuck Savage and Eddie Hawkins. Special thank you to Jeremy Essig for 6 Degrees and to Sarah Wessling for the Guilty Pleasures vocals. Our website is rockthecashbarpodcast.com, and there you can find links to our Spotify playlist and to our Patreon. Thank you for tuning in, and we will see you next week.